way more, like, you know what, more so than from like stuff like radio or other DJs. It sounds bad to say, but like, I get like the most of the stuff I discover is from movies or like TV shows or skate videos or like fucking being in like a Shoppers Drug Mart and like hearing like
if Shoppers has good music.
Yeah,
actually.
Like, dude, they were playing this like Richard Marx tune the other day, and I got on this whole like Richard Marx kick.
The Freshco, when the new Metro opened at Queen and Dufferin, and with, you know, with the Starbucks downstairs and the new fancy Metro, the main reason why I still persisted, not out of dedication and, you know, to what do I owe the fucking local Freshco, but the Freshco right north of the Gladstone there, every time I'm in there, it's like I'm playing a fucking yacht rock set for myself. Like, you just, it's crazy. You walk in there and I'm just like, oh, this is a great track. You know what I mean? It's like they're playing Seals and Croft, and they're playing, you know, Christopher Cross, and then they're playing Doobie Brothers.
Welcome to This Broken Mixtape, the podcast that rewinds and presses play on the soundtrack to your life. I'm Jeff Wu.
I'm Justin Lee.
For over a decade, Dave and Ray, DJ Lazyray, Gillespie, otherwise known as the infamous Gillespie Brothers, have thrown some of the wildest parties in Toronto. Playing an eclectic blend of 70s and 80s rock, funk, disco, and pop rarities and classics, the brothers know how to command a dance floor. And just like trumpet legend Dizzy Gillespie, the brothers have an endless lung capacity and the gift to riff like jazz. As you'll hear in just a few seconds, Dave and Ray essentially hijack our podcast, and for the first time in the history of This Broken Mixtape, the interview goes deep off the rails. The end result was a two-hour conversation about sex, drugs, and rock and roll that warranted our first ever two-part episode. So without further ado, here's part one.
You're tuned into an episode of This Broken Mixtape. We're here live with the Gillespie Brothers, Dave and Ray, a.k.a. Lazyray. Welcome to the show, guys.
What's up?
Thanks for having us, dudes.
This has been 6 weeks in the making, I think. I think we've been trying to make this interview happen.
Well, you know, your people talked to our people, and our people got back to your people. You know, these are busy times, man. End of the summer, everyone's trying to make the most of the fleeting good weather, you know, but we knew we wanted to do this. We just wanted to make sure we did it right.
Today's the day.
All right. We'll put us
you guys
on
ready for this?
Get the firing squad ready, man. Stick us up against the wall. Give us one last smoke and throw down the blindfolds.
If you could look back at, you know, your earliest memory involving music, for most people it would be just music being played in the house, your parents being playing certain vinyl or tapes or what have you. Try to take us back to that moment.
Placido Domingo. Yeah. What is love?
Our dad was and still is, all like, has always been a huge, huge music fan. Tons of records, you know, sound system upstairs, sound system downstairs in the bungalow in Scarborough. I mean, we would have even known it. I mean, I don't know what point you sort of like become aware of musical memories, like as a, you know, just physiologically as a child, remember, but long before, obviously, we ever like were purchasing our own music. Yeah, there was always music in the house. Heavy on the classical, heavy on that. And then you got your sort of popular classical, as Ray said, like, you know, Pavarotti, Placido Domingo.
Not to be fair to Dad, those aren't representative of his
No,
taste.
They are. They are. No, but we're saying that's...
He's way deep. He's into the deep underground classical music.
Lots of Mahler and...
Bartok, Bella Bartok at age 5. So hard to digest that.
So it was mostly actually classical and then jazz. As much as our dad appreciated rock bands, I mean, he loved Frank Zappa and got me into Zappa early on. He loved the Doors. But it was generally like a mix of classical and jazz.
There was like four pop. These are the records that weren't classical or jazz or kids records that we had in the house. You correct me if I'm wrong or add to it. This is what I remember seeing in the basement. The Village People record.
Oh, yeah.
Rick James, Street Songs.
Yes.
Trick of the Tail by Genesis. And, like, that's it. Everything else was classical or jazz. Or
And
like,
the Roaches.
Or
remember Fred,
oh, the Roaches,
Roaches
yeah, the
too.
Roaches. You know, that, and then, like, band. Fred Penner and, like, the Polka Dot Pony got like, heavy repetition.
Well, growing up in Canada, I think everyone, like, every family that has a child, it's, like, government issue to get a copy of, like, Baby Beluga and some Anne Murray and some Fred Penner.
But thing is, like, we had, like, we were record shopping before we were music fans, like, because, okay, you know how, like, a lot of kids, like, say in the suburbs, like, on a Saturday, right, you're out with your dad. Like, a lot of friends I knew, like, their dad would drag them out to, like, Canadian Tire or whatever. Or, like, go kick tires on a, look at cars or, like, whatever. Do all these, like, you know, house projects.
Go buy a take new them chainsaw.
To the, yeah, exactly. Our dad would be taking us to, like, Driftwood, like, to go record shopping with him. So, like, we never, yeah, I mean, I still don't know how to work on a car. But we were getting exposed to, like, being in record stores before we were aware of, like, our own musical tastes or owning anything. But I do have a specific memory about the first record I bought, which was for sure the Culture Club record, because I remember, like, I really wanted it because that was on the radio a lot, and finding it up in North York by Bill and Chris's place. But I can remember the store, and it was like Young and Finch, this place on the would have been east side of Young, and it's like all these like streamer kind of plastic things in the window. Like I couldn't tell you the name of it, not that it would exist anymore, but
we'll have to do some research.
It's a visceral visual image.
But yeah, pretty much as soon as we were aware of the sense of money and ownership of money and having your own individual money that you can spend, I think Ray will agree with me on this, that basically, like, yeah, music was the first thing that we weren't saving up for a bike or skateboards, although that came later for you, I guess. And I mean, not much has really changed. We'll still go into a record store. We'll still go into a record store and blow more money than we really should. I mean, if we had a personal finance officer, they would be going like, hey, slow down. But
crack.
So I think I remember the first record I owned was the first Van Halen record, and then quickly followed by, I mean, once I got a little bit older, 1984, which obviously, like, was, you know, monster record that came out in 1983, so I would have been 8. So I was deep into Van Halen and
I remember when
stuff.
You bought that Van Halen record, actually. I remember because it was out. We bought it at Wilco at the Morningside Mall. and albums were $7.99 and cassettes were $8.99. It was like, oh, do you save a dollar? Back then, cassettes were obviously more, you know, valuable
ironic,
than they are
now.
Now
they're
vinyls. Yeah, but I remember this guy getting, because I remember getting the Duran Duran, Seven and the Ragged Tiger, and him getting 1984.
You were always the poppier radio.
He was into the hair bands. I like the poppy shit. What was on the radio? And I remember Reflex was on the radio, like the number one, top like the top 8 at 8 or whatever, top 7 at 7 countdowns they used to do.
Yeah.
It was like number one forever until Born in the USA.
Yeah, we
came
listened
on.
To a lot of. There was lots of radio too, right? You listen to, you know, CFNY and Q107.
Yeah,
and,
radio
and,
was good then.
I mean, you had shows.
What's the age difference between you guys?
15 glorious months, and I think it shows in my elevated sense of knowledge and wisdom of the world. But yeah, it's only 15
and
months.
Gray hairs.
Yeah. Well, that's most of them due to you. But yeah, there's only 15 months difference between us. So, I mean, we're brothers, but then it's like we're kind of, sometimes people think that we're almost like twins. Because obviously when you're close like that and you have siblings like that or you've got a spouse like that, you can, you know, complete each other's sentences and sort of complete each other's thoughts. So we were like, other than sort of, a wild time period in Ray's teens where maybe between like 14 or 15 and 17 where he didn't really agree with anyone in the world. Other than that, maybe a little period where he fell into like a skater crowd that we didn't really click.
I fell in with the wrong crowd.
Outside of that.
I fell in with these bad kids.
Outside of that, though, we pretty much all, you know, as much as we scrap, I mean, at the end of the day, we see pretty eye to eye on a lot of stuff. And, like, I mean, it's great when you share the passion for something. And obviously, both of us are huge music fans and collectors of music and big fans of seeing live music. But when you also, like, can respect each other's view on music, even if you have differing views on it, it's, you know, it just adds like another like sort of level of depth to the understanding, you know.
So, would you say it's your dad was largely responsible for instilling that passion in music? because
it's like, well, it's a combination of things because okay, there's two things. Like our dad, obviously, and not just our dad, both of our parents were huge lovers of the arts, and it's not just the records, but like they would take us to the symphony, they'd take us to the ballet. Dave played piano. I took cello lessons. They had us. It wasn't just the record thing. It was also just an immersive, yeah, like,
you've got
bourgeois culture. We went to art classes on Saturdays. So like they had us do everything but ballet pretty much. And but then there was a dual influence of like, because as much as our parents were passionate about music, us being into like popular music and stuff doesn't really come from them because they weren't playing that music ever. But we had this babysitter, Betty, who literally just had Chum FM on all the time. And like back in the day, you know, I guess it was like just when like classic rock was developing as like a radio formula in the early 80s. So even though it was like the 80s, I remember hearing Do It Again all the time on the radio, and that's like, you know, that was like 10 years old by 1982 or whatever, right? Or 19, I don't know when that record came out anymore.
But she was definitely of that school of like, you know, babysitting, like take all the kids in the basement, prop them up in front of the TV, and then go back upstairs and kind of leave them to their own devices.
Gilligan's Island was our babysitter, actually.
Yeah, but we watched...
that's a great song. just singing it the other
themes,
day.
You know what? So I was actually going over old themes the other day. You know what's a pretty... Like,
I dropped the Night Court
Magnum
theme today.
P.I.
Tom Scott, baby.
Yeah, Ray and his DJing actually will often play, mix it up and sort of, you know, maybe it's... Even if it's not a dance hall... You know, banger. It's like maybe to wrap it up at the end of the night, you play something that's kind of nostalgic. Like, what have you been playing in the last little while that you really dig?
A
lot of themes to 80s sitcoms and shit.
Well, okay, the obvious, okay, Thank You for Being a Friend by Andrew Gold and the Cheers theme song by Gary Portnoy, I believe, are both classic wind it up, last song at the bar, get the hell out kind of songs. Mm-hmm. But for deeper cuts, I'm kind of into the Growing Pains theme.
Oh, so good.
It's great.
And like the Night Court, like beyond the nostalgia factor, like I'm a fan of Tom Scott's work in general and that like slick session saxophone kind of funk groove vibe anyways. So I say Night Court also theme stands on its own beyond just being a piece of nostalgia, but it's also just like a sick funk groove. So those ones are all pretty killer.
Yeah, I don't know if I can differentiate whether it's nostalgia or I just like it.
But
like,
what
does it matter? You know what I mean? It's awesome. Like if you're nostalgic about something, you know, whether you think that your critical eye is maybe like a little bit off, it doesn't matter. It's
people
like
aren't nostalgic for the shit of that era. Yeah, like if you listen to like rock bands from, you know, people are like, oh, it's nostalgia. It's like, yeah, but then why don't I like, you know, like Bross or whatever. Those two guys are Nelson twins or whatever. Like there's, for anything you could be nostalgic about, there's a shitty version of that. So it's like, you don't like anything just because it's retro. For you take any like niche TV show that you remember, there's a million other ones that, you know, aren't going to stand up. So it's like, if you like Cheers, it's not just because it's old, it's because it's a good show. Problematic.
Well, which, outdated. And that extends to, you know,
music,
the
right?
Music itself too, right? I mean, the reason why these tunes persist, I mean, American Pie excluded in my mind.
Yeah, all, fuck that song.
We all hate that song. But I don't care if he never had to write a song for the rest of his life. I wish he had. But... I mean, for the most part, you know, tunes that persist, whether they're like jazz standards, you know, or they're, you know, rockabilly tunes or Elvis tunes or Beatles tunes, it's, you know, like the power of if something, I mean, it's kind of like the only way you can really judge how effective and longstanding a piece of art is if you, you know, give it enough chance to see whether people forget it, because sometimes shit hits really hard at the time and then fades away, and then other times it's like it's still going strong 50 years later, you know. So I mean,
although some
like,
stuff, to be fair, some stuff isn't meant to last. It doesn't necessarily
it
take away
over
from
people's
its impact
heads, or some people, you know, but
it's
I think
a
lot of good stuff from back then, it's more stuff that I think never really got any traction or never really got pushed, or like, you know, it was just one of those. Sometimes there's those bands that everyone discovers afterwards and then they fell through the cracks or whatever, and you know, and they just have this resurgence years and years later. But that's more just because, you know, some A&R person fucked up or some company went out of business or...
Yeah, the record label went bankrupt and then, you know, Shelter Records style.
Yeah, there you go.
And then now people are listening to Phil Seymour going like, why didn't this guy make it, you know? Or dude, the perfect example is the opening of that movie Searching for Sugar Man, right? Yeah, and it's like before you know that he had this big comeback and you're listening to music and you're just like, how did this guy not, like, it's so good, it should have gotten big, right? Like, how did this guy kind of slip through the sort of music industry apparatus or whatever? But yeah, obviously it happens.
Guys like that. I'm a huge fan of Nick Drake, and it's like, you know, I mean, as anyone, I mean, obviously this is not like some underground knowledge or anything, but you know, here's a guy who like didn't sell any records at all until after he was dead, and obviously like he OD'd at an early.
What was there? There was that crazy stat with him where he like he sold, like, because then Pink Moon was in that Volkswagen Cabriolet commercial. Remember that, right? Mm-hmm. So that was like a big thing of the resurgence. So there, I remember reading this thing that like Nick Drake sold more records in like the week after that commercial came out than he had in the entire 35 or however many years.
Crippling stage fright, so he never played live. And but yeah, I mean, if anyone likes really amazing solo voice guitar, I mean, his finger picking is amazing. I always thought that the guy Stuart, what's his name? We went to see the show. You know, the Scottish dudes. Come on,
Bell and Sebastian.
Yeah, Bell and Sebastian. Yeah. His voice always kind of reminded me a little bit of Nick Drake.
Yeah, Drake is like if Bell and Sebastian had a baby with Bert Jansch or like Pentangle or one of those like.
Yeah, so he's great. And I mean, we're all like, Ray's been into it like a huge power pop sort of phase that lasted a while. But, you know, those Big Star, the first and second record, Big Star, the eponymously titled one, and then number one record, like, those are just like you listen to that record and you're just like, this is, the songwriting is amazing, the performances are great, the production is perfect. I mean, you just get that stuff that slips through the cracks, which is why, like, it's one thing that I'd really do, like, it's probably the thing I like most about the internet and how it ties into music is your ability to sort of, like, flow from one, you know, rabbit hole to another, to another, to another. I mean, half the time I'll listen to some obscure track, you know, and YouTube it, and then I just look at the vertical line, like, to my right, and then see what is being tossed around and what's referenced and what someone or some algorithm has considered sort of, and then I'll just click on that. And like most of the time, maybe it doesn't end up being exactly what you want. But I guess my friends are now signed up to, is it Sirius that like once a month tosses you, I think it's.
Is it Spotify you're talking about? Once a week?
Oh yeah, Spotify. Discover Weekly. Once a week, and then it gives you what, 10 tracks or something?
Well, it just analyzes like all your data and then
it's
gives you.
It basically tosses out suggestions, I guess, once a week, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Based on your listening habits and like, yeah.
That's cool. I mean, it's... sorry, everyone. Everyone listening at home.
My suggested looks on YouTube are literally only fucking vintage WWF clips.
Yeah, well, there you go.
I watched an hour supercut of every WrestleMania promo.
We've been going through a heavy...
Seriously. Yeah, it was amazing.
I guess now that we've like entered our 40s,
speaking of nostalgia,
gone through a heavy...
I kind of want to address that, though. So like when we saw you at Bell and Sebastian, I was like, wow, I'm kind of surprised to see Dave here. And it's not that you're not into new music, but... You guys are known for definitely when you go to a Gillespie set, you'll be hearing a lot of 60s, 70s, and 80s. Not that you wouldn't be hearing anything new, but you guys definitely have like this. That's what I think we enjoy about your sets is like you're going to hear music that you haven't heard before. That's like, you know, that's everybody. You go to any bar in Toronto and it's almost always going to be hip hop.
Yeah.
Right. And it's like nothing against those DJs. But it's like, it's kind of great to go to.
They're just not as good.
Other than that, it's nice to have variety and having a city as big, you know, what's the one thing you always hear about Toronto, right? It's so cosmopolitan, right? It's like, it's so much variety, right? So we have such a reputation for that in terms of like food, in terms of neighborhoods, all the different cultures and stuff. Mm-hmm. And it should be like that musically as well, I think, you know what I mean? And I think it used to be a little more so. And I say this as someone who plays hip hop. Like, I know I'm known for the retro thing, but as a working DJ also, I play like tons of new stuff. But you guys aren't at those gigs usually because they're like, you know what I mean? They're more either like corporate or clubby or something. But I definitely noticed there's like a sort of a really in the last like couple of years, maybe 5 or 6 years in the small bars, sort of a homogenizing effect of a lot more just trap. And kind of new school mumble rap. Like, it's not even just rap. It's, like, harder. It's hard to even go really hear like traditional or whatever golden age kind of style rap, boom bap kind of stuff, right? Yeah. It's more trappy kind of modern stuff, which I also like that stuff too, but it's, you know, it's cool. In the city of Toronto, you should be able to go out on any given night and hear, you know, you should be able to go hear techno, you should be able to go hear deep house, you should be able to go hear funk and soul and disco, you should be able to hear current top 40 and rap, you should be able to hear fucking, you know, whatever, Zydeco, I don't know. But so we, you know, this kind of like, when him and I do parties together, it's more like our musical story together. Mm-hmm. But then we also have our own, like, he likes a lot of metal and shit that I'm not as into, and it's like,
come on now. But there's a difference. There's a difference between music that you listen to at home and music that you'll play out in a crowd. And it's like,
true, but
I mean, sometimes just every once in a while I'll talk to a friend and think, hey, what would be like the feasibility of even doing an old school metal night? Like, you know, I'm not new metal, because as much as I might hate new rap, I also hate new metal. Like,
Don't say hate. That's an ugly
word. Sorry. All right. I despise. I
like disapprove. You love it less.
I love it the least amount.
See, but thing is, like, for me, it's not just about, like, I don't really care for a lot of new rock bands. Sure. Like, so when I'm playing rock and stuff like that, it's definitely more going to be always like 70s, 80s stuff, with the exception of Ariel Pink. Who's playing at the Phoenix on Monday. Y'all should go.
By the way, I picked up your tickets. You owe me like $65.
Yeah, you guys got to go, man. He's the shit. But not for everyone, but he's a bit out there. But like for current music, like I love like new dance hall. Mm-hmm. It's like in terms of like the genres of music in 2017 that I buy the most of, it's 100% dance hall. But it's hard to find places to play it.
But you're okay. Obviously, you're up on new music simply because you're playing, you know, to venues that people, that's what they want to hear. I mean, obviously, from a professional point of view, you need to have all that music and you need to be well versed in that stuff. But how often do you discover a new track? Because do you ever download an album or something, or are you just getting like the track that you already know is a big hit?
No, I mean, look, I do the same thing as you were saying with YouTube, where you go, you spiral into, you just buy something. Like I that's the way I discover shit. But I honestly get music way more, like, you know what, more so than from like stuff like radio or other DJs. It sounds bad to say, but like I get like the most of the stuff I discover is from movies or like TV shows or skate videos or like fucking being in like a Shoppers Drug Mart and like hearing, like,
if Shoppers has good music.
Yeah,
actually.
Like, dude, they were playing this like Richard Marx tune the other day, and I got on this whole like Richard Marx kick.
The Freshco, when the new Metro opened at Queen and Dufferin, and with, you know, with the Starbucks downstairs and the new fancy Metro, the main reason why I still persisted, not out of dedication and, you know, to what do I owe the fucking local Freshco, but the Freshco right north of the Gladstone there, every time I'm in there, it's like I'm playing a fucking yacht rock set for myself. Like, you just, it's crazy. You walk in there and I'm just like, oh, this is a great track. You know what I mean? It's like they're playing Seals and Croft, and then they're playing, you know, Christopher Cross, and then they're playing Doobie Brothers, and then they're playing something where I'm like, you know, like sometimes I actually gotta, like, I don't know why I'm an idiot for not having Shazam on my phone, but I've at least learned, like, if I remember the lyrics and what they're repeating in the chorus, and I immediately just type in lyrics and type them into Google,
I used to do that before Shazam.
You know what drove me insane, like in a pre-Shazam era, was two different times, like 4 months apart, I was in a rental place for gear, because like I'm a photographer, that's my day job. And I was in a place called Film Plus up like Symington, like in DuPont. And this song played, and I was like, what the fuck is this song? It's so good. And the people in there were like, it's Steve Miller. And I was like, it's not Steve Miller. And they were like, it's Steve Miller. And I was like, listen, you fucking guys, just shh. I need to hear what this thing is. And I can guarantee you it's not Steve Miller. And then I heard it again, like 4 months later, maybe like in a grocery store or maybe in a local Choppers or something. And this time I was able to do that thing. And I was like, what are they saying? Sow, so what? And it was Sal Salido, Summer Nights. And it's this band called Diesel, like this Dutch band that came out of like Holland in the 70s, but they
wait,
had this...
they were Dutch and they came out of Holland?
Yeah. Get it? All right. You know what? Trying to... So anyways, but yeah, and it's just like, but it happened to be a big, it's funny where you get these tunes that become a big hit somewhere else, right? So this was like a Dutch band, but it happened to really get traction in Canada, so like in 1980 or something like that. So I was able to, like, you know, and that you actually had, I guess it's like anything pre internet or pre Shazam, it's like if you want to find a track, I mean, it was the same thing when Ray used to DJ years and years ago. It's like even there would be guys or girls, I guess, I mean, not many of them, but there should have been more, but there was like, so, but there was, but
when people transpotting your shit, man,
but you could have a shitty, like a shitty DJ, but they had these really rare, you know, records in their crates, or maybe they just had a lot of money, or maybe they like mm-hmm. were, had
there's
rich
still
parents.
Some of those.
So it's like they,
no
at
names,
least,
we'll
so, so all these rare records that are expensive records that are hard to find. It's not about how good the DJ was. It was just that DJ just happened to have access to that shit, or they happened enough money to buy it. And someone else, like, the idea of, like, I mean, kids will never, ever really understand unless they're, like,
that,
sort
they
of
don't
a very
know the
specialized
pain we went
group.
Through.
They're never going to understand the idea. Like, a kid now can want a bike, okay? Like, if they want a new BMX bike, they can't just download one. You know what I mean? It's like they have to physically have a bike, right? If a kid wants a fucking skateboard, if a kid wants, like, a new designer, OVO hat or something, you know what I mean? They still have to get it. But since music has stopped being a thing that comes in a physical, tangible form that needs to be acquired, that you physically need to go and get and pay for it, no kid is ever going to really, like, feel the pain of wanting some kind of music and not immediately just being like, oh, I can just have any music I want.
And that, therefore, it becomes less meaningful because you don't have to pay for it. And you could go on and on. This is a whole other, like, podcast almost, but it's like,
yeah, we'll have you guys come back.
Never
and talk
mind.
About this.
Never mind the, like, the difference of having a physical artifact versus having, just some nebulous, like, ones and zeros. Like, you know, so I'm talking with my hands here. You guys can't see. I just did a sick.
He was gesticulating wildly.
Yeah. But, like, so there's the difference in having, like, a physical artifact versus, like, just a piece of information. But more than that, it's just that it's fucking free. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And once it's free, it just will never be as valuable to people. And because it doesn't represent any type of sacrifice to you. Whereas, like, even a record that costs $2, like, you still had to somehow get that $2, whether you earned it with your time, however you got it, right? It represents a piece of your life that you're giving up to get this thing. And therefore, it'll always be more special. And as much as, you know, obviously, like, I mean, I still buy everything. I mean, I double buy shit. I'm like the biggest sucker. I don't just steal it. I buy the record and then I go buy it on iTunes so I can have it digitally because I'm too lazy to fucking rip my records even. But
I thought your whole thing a little while ago was that you disputed the actual bit rate, like the quoted bit rate that iTunes says.
No, well, yeah. I mean, I would love iTunes to sell AIFFs or whatever, but that's never going to happen. So I'll take a three, or I'll take a 256, I guess they sell, whatever, bitrate MP3. Yeah, they don't even sell you 320. I would pay more. If it was $1.29 or whatever it is, 99 cents or $1.29 for their compressed, I would pay $2 for a 320, and I'd pay $3 for, you know, an AF, but I represent a very slim, most people won't even pay the 99 cents, they'll just fucking steal it anyways, right?
Yeah.
So
it is crazy, though, that once you get to the point where you're literally like,
no, there's no price, like, low enough. Like, if they were like, you know what, you could pay $5 a year and have all the songs you want, still most people would be like, yeah, but why? I can still steal it. Like, you know what I mean? There's no price. If it's like this, here, buy this MP3 for 2 cents. But why would I pay 2 cents when it's free?
And you think about it, right? Like, we were thinking about this.
Never mind the royalties that the artist gets and helps to create the art, right?
But music hasn't gone up in price. I mean, we were thinking about that. You know, me and Ray were really shaken, obviously, just as, you know, many, many people were when Tom Petty died. And it, you know, I mean, obviously, beyond his amazing catalog of just awesome music and him being a rad dude and a great performer and a great collaborator and a writer of other people's tunes and shit like that, it's one of his coolest baller moves when, you know, obviously it's like, it's not like an obscure story, but when he fought his record label to keep his records at the same price as everybody else. Mm-hmm. But one thing that, so when I think Hard Promises came out, which was his third record, and then he was battling with his record label, which I think was MCA. But basically, I guess the standard price for a record was, like in 1980, was $8.99, and they wanted to charge $9.99 because they knew that people would pay it. And they
fourth record, actually.
Okay, fourth record. Whatever. Look, we're splitting hairs.
Who cares, anyways, though?
The whole point is, I remember when I was like sort of researched, like I knew that story, but I went back and I was like, holy shit, like $8.99 in 1980, it's like, that seems like a fair bit of money. You know what I mean? Like, if you're paying a dollar per track, and I mean, you know, in the 90s where people, because they could put like 62 minutes of music on a CD, they would release 62 minutes and you'd just be
it seems like every album, like, after every album in the 90s, after like Use Your Illusion was like a double album.
You don't need 15 tracks, you know, cut it back. But the whole point is, if let's say you have standard price, let's say you have standard 10 tracks on a record and it's a buck a track, well, that's $10. So I mean, it's really, it's, you're like 30 years later and it's like the price hasn't gone up.
No,
so,
but
I mean,
it has. You're comparing it. The price hasn't gone up to buy a physical, like what an album costs in 1980 is what it costs to buy on iTunes now. So you can buy an album on iTunes for $8.99. But if you want to go to buy that vinyl, it's bullshit. It's the opposite. Yeah, it's like $25.99.
If you look at a download as being, you know, obviously like a scan number in terms of a purchase of a song or an album, or purchasing on iTunes as being, you know, like I look at it like, it's not like if you don't own the physical, the vinyl of it or the CD, it's like you somehow haven't purchased it sort of legitimately, you know what I mean? So but I don't know what the percentages are, but I'd be really intrigued to see, like, if you put out a new record, how many people actually buy it on vinyl? Because I think, because we're such vinyl heads and such collectors, I think we get maybe, or at least I do, get an elevated idea of, percentage wise, how many people actually still buy vinyl?
Well,
now?
The thing is too, like it makes it seem like everyone, because it's having this big resurgence,
it's
easy to double the sales when the sales are like very little, right? So it's like for vinyl to get increasingly huge, it's relative to what they used to be selling, but it's still not relative to like what the CD market would have been in like 1995 or something.
I mean,
right?
How many copies of any of these reissues or any of these things get really sold? You know what I mean? On vinyl, I'm talking about. I mean, if you put out a new release, how many people buy, you know, a new Jay-Z album on vinyl? You know what I mean? Ugh. How many people
he
buy?
He paid Motorola to buy all the vinyl copies.
We don't have to talk about that, but I don't know. I mean, it's kind of like it seems weird. I mean, who's going to buy the new, like what kid is going to buy the new Taylor Swift record on vinyl? I feel like that only the person who's going to buy a new Taylor Swift album on vinyl is
Brian,
like,
Kim.
Yeah, like a 40-year-old
dude. Brian
Kim. Brian Kim, we're calling you out on the air.
No, you know what? There is a huge market for that, because there are people that kids that get into vinyl like on a very casual basis. So they're not going to buy every record.
No.
They'll buy like one record maybe like every 2-3 months.
Exactly.
And if they like Taylor Swift, they'll buy it.
Dipping their feet. Like if you go to Urban Outfitters, right, you'll see they'll like have records now, right?
Yeah.
But they have like, you know, I don't want to like give them any kind of compliments, but like it's not, you know, it's like I wouldn't buy a record from there, right? But like, to their credit, you know, there's like maybe some 13-year-old goes in there and buys a fucking Television record because they have a Television record there, or a Strokes record, or a fucking Ramones record. Like they have some cool shit. It's not like just people going buying like trashy. Not that Top 40 is trash anyways, but I like that stuff.
No,
but, you know,
I mean, it's decently curated. It's like someone looked at the Mojo magazine must have records of the last 40 years and they went like, let's have, you know, the
top 40. Sure, but if you don't live
in
Toronto, if you live in anywhere else in Canada, but like
I can't even imagine
how hard it would be to get a record. And if you were like a 12-year-old and you had just heard, like, you know, he had a cool older cousin or something, or your fucking dad, who's probably younger than us, you know, I was like, oh, yeah, you know, whatever, this, like, obscure sort of post-punk, you know, cool record. Like, for someone to, you know, for a 12-year-old in, like, I don't even know. I can't think of any small towns right now. Name a small town.
But Oshawa, Timmins.
Yeah, there. So you know, Welland, you know, if a 12-year-old in Timmins Coburg, can go into
shoutouts to Coburg.
Yeah, can go into Urban Outfitters and buy like a Modern Lovers record. Then you know.
I guess what I'm saying is, it's like,
can't
look,
hate on that.
It doesn't. I think it's an illusion, though. I think the resurgence of vinyl is an illusion. I mean, I think it's like just because of like a few shittily made, what is it, Crosley, you know, these new...
Yeah, Crosley, I mean, turntable.
You know,
yeah.
You know, you get these shitty made turntables. I was out in Prince Edward County this weekend at a friend had just bought a new property, a new cottage, and this was like one of these turntables. I don't know where it was from. I mean, I love Sonic Boom, but I'm saying they're not responsible for the quality control of these turntables. And my pal had just fucking bought the thing, like 150. It wasn't like $40. It's like $150 after tax. It's like a $180 turntable, which is what, like, if you are in the know a little bit, you can actually get like a cheap basic kind of turntable for $180.
Yeah. Yeah.
And literally, like, we were playing this shit at, like, it's like the first time out of the box, and I'm listening to it going like, I can hear it going,
That was
and
in
I'm
the
like,
song, dude.
Yeah, Dave Wall. Like,
you were on mushrooms,
Dave
though.
Wall, no, Dave Wall, I was on mushrooms.
Yeah, see?
But people who were not were also like, is that some part of the song? Or is like, why is
okay,
it wavering?
Look, saying, the quality look, of look, those record players has nothing to do with, that's some company trying to cash in on.
But what
a,
I'm saying is that's, but that's what people,
players?
That's what people are doing. But people are buying, like,
regardless of what their turntable choice, though.
But the turntable is the thing that you're playing it off of. How can you be like, well, okay?
Okay, but so if you build a record collection, you're married to that turntable forever.
No,
you could build
but
a
what I'm saying is, if someone
okay,
was just,
no, just
getting
here, just stop for one second. Okay, listen. Sorry, this is the brother shit coming out here. Okay, my point is this: regardless of, obviously, look, if people are gonna cash in on the fact that people are buying records again and then pump out cheap record players, fine. Okay,
but then people are gonna buy those records,
oh
know
God,
how much expensive they are. But put them on a $150 Chinese, like, piece of shit, all plastic. Whoa. Fucking turntable. They're Chinese made. Okay, sorry. Everyone, I apologize. China has always produced the greatest audio equipment of all time. Japan.
Actually, you know what? China is actually putting out some pretty decent
Look, the
stuff.
Point is, regardless of turntables, we're talking about
I'm
music.
I'm not hating on
we're
China.
Talking about music,
it's a great
okay?
place.
Listen, we could talk about how shitty the cars are that they went to drive to the record store, too.
Okay.
The point is this. If people are actually willing to invest money in the music they buy, that's a good thing.
I agree.
Okay? Because how can you expect anyone to make good music if you can't make money as a band and then you have to break up because you have to get jobs? If no one can make money, if you can't get paid to make music, music's going to be worse. Can we all agree on that,
yeah,
right?
But we also have to understand that no one's ever going to make music anymore as a musician by
Crosley
selling records.
Crosley fucking turntables are not holding back the record industry.
No, it's holding back the people who are buying records and trying to use them to play those records because everyone tells them records sound better. Then you buy a $150 piece of shit, you put your $35 record on it, which costs...
Dude, you mangle your records, no offense.
Well, I'm just saying a brand new one out of it.
You mangle
anyways,
your records.
Anyways, I just think... I think if anyone looks at what's involved in buying records and curating a record collection and then getting all of the gear around it to get like a halfway decent system, they're probably going to be, and I wouldn't be surprised by it, fuck it, I'll just go back to my headphones and I'll go back to my phone. And it's like, I can, you know, like, I understand
they're
that.
Buying
like,
the records because they're cool. They can't hear the difference anyways.
Course,
they can't fucking
course,
hear the difference.
Course.
It's that's what it is. It's cool, and it's the only thing you can't fucking copy and steal. So the record industry wants to push it because they can actually make money, and they can, and it has like a cachet. And it's like, there's only playing shows and selling vinyl now. Like, there, I mean, all the streaming stuff, apparently, I don't know. I'm not like
licensing.
Some industry
Come
guy.
On, licensing, man. You want to license your shit to everybody these
No, well,
days.
Okay, yeah, but we're just talking about like actually being an artist right now. But I'm not talking about like selling songs to commercials, right? But the thing with, from what I hear about the like Spotify and, mm-hmm. and stuff like that is that the royalties are like nothing.
Yeah,
right? So it doesn't matter how many people how many people stream your shit, you're not going to make money off it, really, right? That's that is my
MP3s
understanding
all night
wrong.
Long. But I'll tell you one thing that I noticed. This is one thing that I think as an old timer and Ray as well have, and you know, you cats as well.
We're old timers.
No, he's an old timer. And
well,
us,
you guys,
and
you guys are
well.
Asian, so it's like you guys don't age the rate that we do. You know what I mean? You guys still look like young bucks.
Take it easy, all right?
You guys still look like young bucks.
You got the one pass on the Made in China thing, but now it's now it's starting to become a. You know, it's starting to become a little trend here.
So look. So anyways, look, man, I'm trendy. Okay, so look, but this is what I wanted to say, that this is what I believe, you know, and we've been going and seeing a lot of shows the last couple of years. And by shows, I mean for us, a lot of like old shows.
Just going to plug every show, maybe like after this podcast.
Okay,
like
so let me make this point.
Live Nation is going to call me up.
Let me make this one point, and then I'll make 17 others.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Sorry, I haven't been letting you talk much. Sorry.
So because there's been such an importance put on live music, and live music is where everybody generates their income now, because obviously it doesn't happen from record sales anymore. I feel that even with the older cats, with the classic rock artists, whether they're, you know, like the Pink Floyds or the, you know, Deep Purples or the Christopher Crosses or, you know, Alice Coopers or whatever, I feel like that because there's such an onus put on that, that even those old guys now have to step up their game, because they can't just, you know, ring out a tour and sort of just like phone it in.
No more mailing it in, man. People got to come correct
on
the live shit,
which
is
good.
And
I honestly believe that you see these summer packages, or, you know, you see these old classic rock bands, and I think in 2017, you're getting a better live performance than you maybe would have 12, 14, 15 years ago when they were still old back then, but they hadn't gotten hip to the fact that that's it. Like, if the word gets out, you know, on, you know, chat rooms or internet forums or your like fan sites, that yo, these guys can't cut it anymore.
People
these,
be
these
talking
guys
about Alice Cooper on Chat Roulette all
yeah,
day.
Yeah, yeah, Chat Roulette, Alice Cooper, man.
Huge.
I'm looking for a
he's
golfing
huge.
Buddy. Okay, but no, seriously though, and
no,
I,
it's true.
I think
live
I
shows
honestly,
are great now.
I'm
live
wrong.
Shows, if you're gonna, was,
I honestly
especially
think
if you're gonna go see a legacy.
There's never
act.
Been a better time to see an old, like if you go, it's 2017. I should have seen them in 1996. I think you're wrong.
Yeah.
I think it's like, if they're still fucking alive and they can still get up on stage and sing, now's a better time because...
Yeah. No, if you could see them in 77, sure, maybe. But I mean, look, Guns N' Roses is a perfect example. They're playing here this weekend. They're probably more sober and not hating each other than they've been. Like, you're probably going to get more. Like, if you pictured seeing Guns N' Roses as a band that just fucking is like a sick band that is just going to rip it up for 3 hours... And like, you probably have a better chance of getting that this year in 2017 than you did in fucking 1989, when like Axl would show up at like 1 o'clock and you'd be waiting around. Maybe they're not going to even play, and they'd be like fucked up on heroin, and like, you know what I mean? It's like your odds of getting a quality show now, even if they look, you know, they don't look as, you know, pretty.
They look different.
Axl's still
they
pretty.
Look different.
Axl's
they
still look kind of pretty. But you know what I mean? Like, you kind of like...
It looks a lot like that Benny
he
Hill
looks like
thing.
Benny Hill. But
stop. Well, I love Benny Hill. Hey, I love... You know what? Benny Hill...
Hey, man.
Benny Hill was
I
my first porn.
I heard they added yakety sax to their lives.
Benny Hill was my first access to porn.
I really like Benny Hill also, okay, so you're like not alone. I totally love Benny Hill.
No, but just
the point
just
is
saying.
That, yeah, obviously, like, the shows are tighter now, right? And yeah. The thing is, like...
You can't phone it in with the session guy. They got to get good session people, and, like, they can't just, like, cobble together a bunch of people and just trundle out some fucking, like, circus act. It's like... Because they you live and die by the sword now, man.
And it's funny, like, because it's done a complete 180, right? Like, back in the day, you'd put out an album, right? And you would tour to promote the album, right? And then you'd sell fucking 10 million, you know, records or whatever. Now it's the opposite. Now it's like people will almost like give away the record to support the tour. So it's like now the album is promo for the live tour as opposed to the other way around, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Smart. I mean, if no one's... I mean, that,
totally.
Go see
they have
old
to hustle.
Acts.
Yeah.
Support.
Yeah.
Support, you know, support
so
your.
It
your
might
local
not be a golden age
for
buying
act.
Albums, but it is definitely, especially like if you want to go see those legacy acts, you know, like, and, you know, you're
and, and yeah, I mean, like, look, it's like we just saw fucking Tom Petty in the summer, man. He just did his 40th anniversary tour, big ass tour. Looked great. Sounded amazing. Like,
fuck, dude. Yeah, what a show.
I mean, who would have guessed if you cut back to 2 years ago? Like, let's say, you know, 2 years ago, that Tom Petty would be dead, that Prince would be dead. I mean, like, Prince was
Bowie.
In his fucking 50s, man. George Michael would be dead. Like,
fuck, yeah.
You know, Glenn Frey would be dead. Like, it's, honestly, it's like there's no...
You never know. You don't
never
even have to be old.
Know.
Like
this whole, our approach, I mean, I don't want everyone to go out and start buying tickets because I want to still be able to buy a cheap
Yeah, but see
t-shirt.
Every show, people. See every show. Because assume it's the last time they're ever going to come to Toronto.
Yeah.
You
this
can't go wrong.
This whole idea of like, I'll catch them on the next tour.
No.
You know, how many people said that?
I know a personal friend who whiffed on the last Prince show and the last Petty show, and they both passed away within a few months of having played here. And they, you know, just you never know. And they don't have to be old. It could be... You know, for example, like when D'Angelo came back like a couple of years ago, I fucking like was in tears when I found out about that show because like I just thought I would never ever ever see him again, right? I think most of us thought he was like off the rails forever, right? And then he came back, and it's like that feeling I felt of like having like a second chance, and I was like, oh my god, I can fucking see this dude. You know, I mean, that's really the approach you should kind of take with any
like,
band.
As a perfect example, like you know, I don't pretend to know like super knowledgeable about R&B, but like. He's a player, you know what I mean? He's a musician. He was always a musician first. Yeah, I mean,
he's a musician's musician,
like,
man.
His whole
sure.
thing was like, oh, all right, I happen to just be like a ripped, good-looking dude, but like, so obviously people are going to like, you know, capitalize on that for album cover art or whatever else, but it's like, he's still a musician first, you know what I mean?
Yes, he's more than just the untitled video.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I take pride in that because I'm not an amazing musician or a ripped dude, so it's like I never have to worry about these dilemmas, you know what I mean?
You're still pretty, though.
Yeah, pretty annoying.
You've been listening to part one of This Broken Mixtape featuring Toronto's infamous Gillespie Brothers. If you like what we do, we would really appreciate if you would share a podcast with your friends, and also if you would rate us so that we can reach more listeners. Also, be sure to check out thisbrokenmixtape.com, where you'll find this episode's Spotify playlist and all of our other past interviews. Return next week for part two of our candid conversation with the Gillespie Brothers. Thanks for listening. Until next time.